No mess, no fuss, just pure impact. Fucking Borstal.
Recording here live with 3/5 of the UK's latest new hardcore creation, Borstal. We got Jamie, we've got the wondrous Nick Barker, and the idiot in the middle is my old mate Lee Kitchener. How you doing, gents?
Good,
yeah,
brother.
Yeah, good, mate. Really good.
Yeah, we're doing good, man.
Excellent. So you have probably seen that I gave the at Her Majesty's pleasure a rave review this week at Arve Nocturne. 6 tracks of blistering street punk meets UK hardcore. How did it come about?
This guy.
So Nick.
Well, I wanted to do like a punk hardcore band for a long time. Quite a few years, and it just never seemed to happen. You know, I approached different people, but it was just like one of them things, like no one was biting. And one day I just happened to mention it to Lee and Wes, you know, just like as a matter of fact. And they were like, oh shit, you know, we'd be totally into doing something like that. That'd be ace. And within a week they were sending me riffs and stalking me and mithering and pestering, you know, and it was great because like all the riffs and ideas they had, it was like exactly what I was thinking. So when we got together, like when was it? Last January?
Yeah, last year. Yeah.
Last January was the very first time we got together and jammed, and yeah, everything just. And then eventually we got Pierre in, and then Jamie, and it's just great to work with bunch of guys that are like, they're my bros, and we're on the same wavelength and the same page when it comes to the music, as well as, you know, on a personal level, it's all good, it's fun.
So who writes the lyrics? Is that Pierre or is it amongst all of you?
Yeah, Pierre's written all of the lyrics so far. Like, he wants our input too, you know, because obviously, you know, Wes was a is the vocalist in Dripback, and he's great with his lyrics, man. So I'm sure Wes has got plenty of ideas to throw about. And, you know, we just look for stuff that works well with the riffs, different timings and any ideas like that. We'll just throw it at Pierre and he pieces it together. So it all works pretty well.
And the decision to name the band Borstal, because the thing is, I've got to say, Lee, I think you and Jamie and Wes are too young to even know about Borstal. You know, that's, I've had a couple of mates who went to Borstal, but they're even older than me. I mean, Borstals were gone by the time I was in secondary school.
I'm only 17.
Well, I know. Yeah, definitely.
We're a very tough paper round, like.
we just thought the name.
We wanted something that represented like the British institution, that all, you know, all of its ugliness, and, you know, like there's parallels with like, you know, the prison system, like the monarchy, you know, it's everything's all fucked and broken on, you know, at each end of the scales, you know, from the street level right up to Buckingham Palace.
Yeah,
you know,
obviously the name portrays we're all massive fans of the film Scum.
Yeah,
that played a massive part in it. Is I don't know if you've seen the pre-release of the records, instead of side A and B, we've got A wing, B wing, things like that. It's just like Barker said, you mentioned the name Borstal in a prison sense, and it just conjures up brutality and nastiness,
and it's just British
as well. It's British,
yeah,
you know.
We wanted something that was nasty, hard-hitting, you know, something that represents, you know, the British institution. And, yeah, fuck it, Borstal, that's, you know, I mean, I remember being threatened with it when I was a kid.
Yeah.
You know, if you don't do good, you'll get sent to Borstal.
Yeah.
You know, and it's...
straight to the greenhouse for you.
Well,
yeah,
God, the potting shed, oh, dear. Yeah. Now, listening to the beginning, the intro... You're using some news clips, but dropping some truths, because you guys, I mean, I don't know if Lee realises this, but my day job, I work in youth justice. So I work with kids. I support kids who are in trouble, and I try and do groups and stuff with kids to stop them going to prison. And I, one of my jobs is, you know, speaking on behalf of young people who are in trouble. And you talk about something which we work with all the time. In the intro, it talks about things called ACEs, which are adverse childhood experiences, which are one of the main things that are the drivers for young people who get involved in serious youth violence. And I think one, hardcore and metal and punk are things that often, and nowadays hip hop as well, are things that can divert young people away from a bad street life into a good street life. So I think that's a story that goes through those six tracks as well, which is really important.
Yeah, nice. Well, with the intro, we wanted something that reflected, you know, yeah, the state of Britain, you know, like on the streets, you know, with the gun, you know, with the knives and the guns, the, you know, and it's where we've got all the deaths and different samples. And like you said, the other one, you know, like where does it, all of this come from? You know, those adverse childhood experiences, you know, and yeah. In the end, it's like, fuck it, just going to shank you up.
There's some, but I mean, aside from that, the riffs on the EP are huge. Absolutely huge.
Lee owns us.
Well, Lee owns them.
I own everything. No, it was, you know, me and Wes, we have a... We've been in a few bands together now, you know, so we know each other's writing style. We write well together and we both bounce off each other. So as soon as Barker asked us about this project, we were sitting on ideas that we were already working on for, you know, a thrash band we used to be in. We were talking about bringing that back, and there was a lot of riffs that we were already working on for that. But it was never really going to happen. So as soon as this project came up, it's like we were already sitting on a load of stuff. And yeah, it's just, it was easy. It was easy to piece it together, you know? So it's a combination of both of us, but Jamie's been writing some fucking shit hot stuff as well. So we've got some really good stuff in the pipeline.
They got the riffs together, and I'm kind of like the, I can't write riffs, you see, but to me, they're like jigsaw pieces. I'll figure out in my head, maybe we should start like this and break here, you know. That's my contribution.
So did you enjoy playing in a different style, Nick? I mean, the whole fact that it's not black or death metal or grindcore, and you're playing, it must have been kind of freeing, was it, to play in a real street punk hardcore style?
Yeah, well, I've never done it before, really, you know. I mean, with Brujeria and Lockup, you know, you kind of dip your toe in it a little bit, but that's just grind. But to do like a full-on like punk hardcore thing, you know, it's been, like I said, something I wanted to do for a long time, and finally I'll get to do it with the right people. It's I'm really chuffed. Oh, it's not just a side project either. It's like a real band, you know.
Well, that was going to be my question about the fact that it is. Because I put that in my review. I really hope that it's not just a side project and it's something that's going to have some longevity. And are we going to see it live once we're out of the plague?
Yeah. We're just confirmed for what festival?
It's Spicer.
Spicer Fest.
Where's Spicer Fest?
In Sheffield.
That sounds awesome. Is there going to be curry there?
I hope so.
There better be.
It's us in Sheffield with
the Mulberry, I think.
The Mulberry at the end of November, and that's with Annotations of an Autopsy and Street Soldier and a bunch of hardcore and beatdown bands. But that's the first thing we've confirmed. But we've got a couple of other exciting things. Sitting there ready to come out. So
there's a big announcement coming.
Yeah.
Well, I'll be up for that because the ex-guitarist of my band and my tattooist is in Annotations of an Autopsy. So
there you go.
That could be a good weekend up in Sheffield. So how did you get your dad involved then, Lee?
Oh, in the... No, he... he only did the he did the spoken intro.
Yep.
King of the Jungle, obviously, but straight away we were, as soon as we did it, because on the album of the King of the Jungle with King of the Jungle, there's no spoken intro, but they released it. They did a new version of it later on, and they had the intro, no mess, no fuss. Just
yeah, yeah. I've got it. I've got the reissue that was on Captain Oi.
Yeah, that's it. That's the one. So yeah. We were like, we had to put it in there, and it was like, but we have to do it for Borstal. And Wes was like, why don't you get your dad to say it? And I was like, yeah, perfect. Let's do it.
Of course, Arthur was happy to oblige.
Yeah, he loved it. Yeah. Yeah.
If you can't pull in family favours for that, what
absolutely.
Can you?
Absolutely. But how was it, though, covering a song your dad wrote?
You know what? I've actually wanted to cover that song for a few years. I'd already, like, been messing around with it, like, a little bit here and there over the years. Like, I was, like, looking at ways to do it in the thrash band and stuff like that. And it just, with Borstal, it just seemed the perfect fit. And I think it was Barker that suggested, why don't we do a Last Resort cover? And I was like, awesome, let's do King of the Jungle. You know, and a bunch of Last Resort songs have been covered by, Madball did Working Class Kids. And they did Violence in Our Minds and Sick of It All done Working Class Kids. But no one had ever done King of the Jungle. And, you know, we're Millwall and King of the Jungle was a Millwall song. So I was like, it has to be King of the Jungle. My dad will fucking love it.
Are you going to play it live?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, 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 absolutely, yeah.
Because Pierre's vocals take it to another level as well, don't they, on that? I mean, it really works well.
Voice is awesome. You know, it's the fucking voice of UK hardcore. Yeah. And I thought it worked perfectly. And you know what? That was the one song when we went to record it, we'd never played it together. None of us had played it together. We literally just turned up in the studio and Barker was sat behind the glass playing the drums and I was air drumming what he should be doing next while he's playing along to my riffs. It actually turned out really well. Like, we were all stoked with how that one turned out. So
it's like I say, with Pierre's voice, it just takes it to a different place. It's like, even when he's speaking nicely, Pierre just sounds pissed off and angry. So what better way to fucking have a song?
And did I notice some Spanish lyrics in there as well, Jamie? Were there from Pierre?
Yeah.
There'll be more of that as well.
I wanted to, because of my connection with Brujeria, and, you know, with also Pierre's Peruvian background and his roots, you know, I said to him, you know, don't be shy to throw down on the Espanol, you know.
Fantastic. You know, if you want.
So he's down for it too, so that's great. And, you know, it's a nice little twist, you know what I'm saying?
Definitely, and it works really well as well.
Yeah,
because exactly. It skips along, it trips off his tongue really well. It's really rhythmic within it. So
with my experience with Brujeria is like, when it's all sang in Spanish, the delivery and everything, it's kind of got like a bit more of a hard hitting edge than if it's sang in English. I don't know if it's because we don't understand it, but it's a bit more hard hitting.
Yeah,
I think it's perfect for hardcore.
Definitely. So for you guys, I've realised you've managed to get together and jam, but it must have been a nightmare. You know, a year ago or January last year, you get together, you finally realise you've got this band of brothers with this bunch of riffs and ideas that you're covering. People with Jamie's writing bass parts, et cetera, and all of a sudden we go into lockdown.
Yeah.
It's got to be everyone I know, every musician I know has said how frustrating it is. But when you've still managed to record something and get it out as well.
Yeah, we were just jumping around the restrictions, you know. So as soon as there was like a little gap where it's like restrictions have been lifted for a bit, like, cool, let's get the record done now, you know. So we're just jumping in everywhere we could, here and there, to get stuff done. And then obviously, you know, with the, you know, lucky to have the internet and shit, innit? So you just record stuff, recording at home, sending it back and forth, and it worked, you know. So I think this is actually... you know, even though it sucks with all of these lockdowns and the lack of shows and stuff like that, it's kind of, in a way, been good for us because it means we could put a record out there that people can listen to and we're not starting off at the bottom pile playing the shows, which with songs that no one's heard, and you know, it's we've got the EP out. We're working on some other stuff. Yeah. So by the time we get round to playing shows and stuff, you know, there's going to be material out there,
and it'll be great because, as you say, people will know the songs, so they'll be singing along.
Yeah, it's
jumping probably around because they know what's coming.
Yeah, we hope so. Yeah,
fantastic. But
it's all down to the internet because, obviously, these lot were in the band. I was the last addition, but I've known Wes since he was 15. We're both from Grimsby, so when he said they needed a second guitarist, I was up for it.
Yeah.
And down to him and Lee doing home recordings, they just sent me them over WhatsApp, and I just sat at home and learnt them. So when it came to a time where we were allowed to jam, luckily I already knew 6-7 of the songs. So it was kind of, it all came together at the right time, really. If it wasn't for lockdown, I wouldn't have been furloughed and I wouldn't have had a chance to learn them. So there's been benefits.
Yeah.
Not many, but
there has been some.
Yeah, but there has been some, and it has worked in our favour because, like you said, we've managed to work around the little gaps we could fit in and get jams together and recording and stuff like that.
So, you know, something that has come out of it is doing interviews like this. We wouldn't have bothered. We would have waited until I could come down and see you or somewhere. We wouldn't have got these kind of interviews. So they're happening more now during this lockdown than would ever have happened before. So I know you're all desperate to go off and eat your curry. What have you each ordered?
Sorry?
What have you each ordered? What's your curry of choice then that's waiting for you?
I'll be honest, I can't remember what I ordered, but mine was limited because I'm vegetarian, so I ordered what I was veggie.
I ordered the Rosala.
I think I got a shashlik boona.
Oh, so Jamie, it looks like you've got whatever's left after that. After they've picked through it.
I wouldn't order anything that included the words lick and boona.
Oh, you can lick my booner anytime, Lee. our normal get-together's gone. No more London Tattoo Convention.
I know, bro. I know. But, you know, we'll see. I'm sure they'll pull something together for next year.
We'll lick your booner.
Yeah. Guys, I look forward to seeing you at the Sheffield show in November. It's been awesome seeing you. Love the EP. Best of luck with the rest of Borstal. Talk to you soon. Cheers, guys.
Thank you very much, Matt. Cheers. Enjoy your evening.